As we gather on this third Sunday of February, on this first Sunday in Lent, we take a moment to acknowledge the land upon which our church sits. For generations upon generations, First Nations people walked these lands. Members of the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, and the Neutral Peoples, their relationship with the land, a central part of their identity and spirituality. We have not always honored their stewardship of the land. And so we recommit ourselves today to living into right relationship with both our First Nations brothers and sisters and the very land, that we might live into a time when all might flourish. Good morning, and welcome to this time and place of worship. Whether you're joining us in real time on Facebook Live or later on Facebook or YouTube, whether this is your first time joining us or you've never missed a service, whether you're in Brantford or England or Korea, welcome and thank you for joining us today. Today we would normally be a special service with our scouts and guides recognizing Thinking Day and Founders Day and hearing about what the scouts and guides have been up to. While we won't be basing our entire service around those two celebrations, Thinking Day, Founders Day, with the scouts and guides, we will be hearing from Brad and Sharon a little later on to hear a little bit about what they've been up to over the past year. And so let us gather together for worship. And if you're in the habit of lighting a candle as we gather, I invite you to light that at this time. We light a candle representing Christ's presence here in our midst. And so let us come into worship in song.
Come all you people, come praise your Maker. Come all you people, come praise your Maker. Come now and worship the Lord. Come all you people, come praise your Maker. Come all you people, come praise your Maker. Come all you people, come praise your Maker. Come now and worship the Lord. Come all you people, come praise your Maker. Come all you people, come praise your Maker. Come all you people, come praise your Maker. Come now and worship the Lord.
And so let us gather as people who are part of the complex interconnectedness of cultures, of countries, of beliefs. Let us gather as people who embrace God, who is holy mystery and holy love. Let us gather together as people who struggle at times to know how to follow in faith. Let us gather together as those who open ourselves to the Spirit's movement within and without. And so let us pray together. Loving God, open our hearts that we may feel the breath and play of your Spirit. Unclench our hands that we may reach out to one another. Open our lips that we may drink in the delight and wonder of life. Open our eyes that we may see Christ in friend and stranger. Breathe your Spirit into us and touch our lives with the life of Christ. Amen. Our opening hymn, again recorded from different locations with the help of a cappella, an app that allows us to do this, Jesus Tempted in the Desert.
Turn these bells.
We all make mistakes. We all do things we later come to regret. Our prayer of confession is a chance to reflect on places in life where we carry brokenness and regret and to release that into God's hands. And even though we're not having an official Scouts and Guides service today, I thought I would honor the tradition of doing an embodied prayer of confession today. A prayer of confession that reflects on different elements of our body. And so let us begin by offering up the mistakes of our mouths. Gracious God, we offer up to you the words we've said in anger or when feeling spiteful or hurt. Lies we've told that we thought didn't matter, or maybe that we got away with. We offer up the mistakes of our mouths. Let us offer up the mistakes of our minds. Holy God, we offer up to you thoughts we've had that cut others down, that were mean about the people around us, or that showed a lack of respect for others, or a lack of respect for ourselves. Negative thoughts about ourselves. Loving God, we offer up the mistakes of our minds. Loving God, we offer up the mistakes of our hearts. We offer up to you the times our hearts were bitter and we refused to forgive, or when we were hardened to others and didn't share or show love. We offer up the mistakes of our hearts. We offer up the mistakes. Loving God, we offer up to you the times we used our hands to do things that brought harm to others, to the earth, to ourselves. The times we were not kind, we offer up the mistakes of our hands. And so let us take the mistakes of our mouths, our minds, our hearts, our hands, and release them to the heart of God. And so as we lift up our heads and our hearts, may we be reminded that if we are open to love and to healing, God will transform us and offer us new opportunities to do better and be better. Nothing we can do can separate us from the love of God. Absolutely nothing. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our family hymn today is I've Got the Joy, Joy, Joy. Time. And today we're going to hear two stories. One is going to take us all the way back to Genesis and involves a covenant. Now, if we were in person, I would probably ask you if you could think of what the different covenants are when we talk about the covenants. And this one is the precursor to the covenant with Abraham and Sarah, and uses as a symbol of that covenant something that still brings wonder to people today. And that is, of course, the rainbow. We're going to be hearing a story that picks up after the story of Noah and the flood, and the covenant with Noah, with humanity, and a sign of that covenant, the rainbow in the sky. I'm going to talk a little bit about that later on. And then we're going to hear a gospel story from the beginning of Mark. I've mentioned several times now, Mark is very short, very to the point. And so in order to make a reading that was more than one verse for today, the first Sunday in Lent, a Sunday where we often hear of the temptation stories, the lectionary picks up, goes back, picks up Jesus' baptism and a few verses after the temptation, because Mark doesn't cover them. He mentions that Jesus spends 40 days in the desert and was tempted, that 40 days being reminiscent of the 40 years that are part of the Moses story and the Israelites in the wilderness. But Mark doesn't really cover it. He just mentions it. We sang through the story in our opening hymn today, Jesus Tempted in the Desert. But we're going to acknowledge the Mark reading because it is the first Sunday in Lent, and so mentioning the temptation. But as we see, Mark doesn't get into any details. He just mentions it. So I'm going to turn it over to Dianne for those two readings. Thanks, Dianne.
The first scripture reading is from Genesis 9, 8 to 17. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I now establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, all those who came to the ark with you, every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant I am making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth." So God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant I have established between me and all life on the earth." This reading is from Mark 1, 9 to 15. The baptism and testing of Jesus. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and the angels attended him. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news."
Cheers.
And so let us pray. And I want to offer a prayer that was posted and I believe written by the creator of Sacred Ice. It's a weekly commentary / reflection / resource of a fairly progressive, social justice-oriented approach to Christianity. And so I offer this prayer. In the damp, dark uncertainty, in the ominous threat of the storm, appears a gentle arc of colors, the rainbow that remembers the light. In the silent questions of doubt, in the disturbing vertigo of your seeming absence, whispers a silent promise, the covenant of your forever being here. I praise you, God, for rainbows and promises, and the courage I find in their comforting presence. Amen. Water, rainbows, earthy images to begin this season of Lent. The necessity of water. Fern Gibbard, Sandra Stickney, and Laura Turnbull, who were the contributors to Gathering for this Sunday and the Sundays of Lent, reflect on the rainbow as the sign of the covenant of promise. The Lenten readings this year have a number of covenants mentioned, a lot of covenant language mentioned. And so we start this first Sunday of Lent with the covenant of promise and the rainbow as that symbol. But sort of starting points for today's service, they point out the importance of water, how essential water is for all life, that the human body can last only 3 or 4 days without water, that we ourselves are mostly water, as are the other plants and animals that surround us. Water has the ability to transform. You can think of canyons dug away over time by water. Water that takes sharp glass and turns it smooth into that sea glass. The very grains of sand on a beach, worn down by water. While the snow is still falling outside and still gathering up, it may seem like spring is a long way away, but I know my mind has turned to the spring as I start to get ready to plant seeds that will be transplanted outside come spring. And I'm reminded of the power of water in kind of a fun way every year at this time. As I take these little pellets, use some water, and watch them pop up into life-giving soil, ready for seeds. Water plays an important role in both of our readings today, the water of baptism in the Mark passage, and the water in the air necessary for a rainbow to appear in the air. In some ways, both water and the sign of the rainbow, the covenant of promise, of importance, of the value of life, both human and beyond. Water is an essential part of that symbol of the rainbow in the sky. The rainbow itself, of course, has taken on meaning of its own over the years, both as a symbol. We have that biblical symbol of the sign of the covenant, but also as a symbol of acceptance and welcome. Of course, readily comes to mind the importance of it in the LGBTQ+ community, the importance of the rainbow as a sign of value and equality of all people. She remembered one of the most beautiful and strongest rainbows I've ever seen. I don't think I've shared this with you before, maybe in a small group, but it was on the final day of the annual meeting of Bay of Quinte Conference back probably 8 years ago now. I've shared before that at the annual meetings of Bay of Quinte Conference, I was involved every year that I was there in the music and worship leadership as part of the musical worship team, and got to be a viola in the band. The year that I'm thinking of, I was also on the local arrangements committee because Peterborough Presbytery, what was then Peterborough Presbytery, was hosting the conference annual meeting. And I was part of Peterborough Presbytery, and so ended up on the local arrangements committee as well. And so I'd been quite involved that weekend. It was sort of, for me, the culmination of many, many months of work. But the really kind of exciting piece of the annual meeting that year was that Bay of Quinte Conference had voted to become an affirming ministry. So a safe and affirming lifting up of all people, regardless of age, gender, orientation, gender identity, all pieces of becoming an affirming ministry. So that last day of the meeting, there was a storm, and we celebrated, we lifted up and celebrated the decision to become an affirming ministry, and then we all set out to head back to our homes. And just as I hit the outskirts of Peterborough, there was the biggest rainbow across the sky. I actually had to pull over because seeing it, I just teared up. It was beautiful. It was such a meaningful moment of that rainbow and the decision we'd made that day as a conference. A reminder of worth and value of all people. This Wednesday, February 24th, is Pink Shirt Day, a day of intentionally recognizing the harm of bullying and the prevalence of bullying, especially in our schools, the huge damage that bullying can do, and the maybe because of social media and the ability of social media, but that has become a real significant problem for a large number of children. And so the Pink Shirt Day to show our support of ending bullying. Jim Taylor, he and Ralph Milton had an e-zine, I think they called it, a weekly email that looked at the lectionary readings. He suggests for this day telling the story of creation, not the creation story in the Bible, but how everything started as an immeasurable point. How every atom of the universe emerged from that one instant. The simple first atoms combined into more complex atoms, into organic molecules, into life. But we still carry within us the stuff of that first instant, however it happened. And so does every other creature, every plant, every planet, every galaxy. in every atom of our bodies, we are related. We are all kin. I know when it comes to water, I was struck when I first learned about the fact that atoms are, that we are, nothing can be created or destroyed. It's, we are the stuff of the stars. The water we drink, I remember this was the image that stuck in my mind when I was learning about this, the realization that the water that I drink, like the dinosaurs drank, that connection to the rest of creation. In our stories today, two powerful reminders that we are mostly water, connected to the rest of creation, washed and welcomed in the act of baptism, our equality radically renewed. In the symbol of the rainbow as a covenant of promise. In the damp, dark uncertainty, in the ominous threat of the storm, appears a gentle arc of colors, the rainbow that remembers the light. In the silent questions of doubt, in the disturbing vertigo of your seeming absence, whispers a silent promise, the covenant of your forever being here. I praise you, God, for rainbows and promises, and the courage I find in their comforting presence. Amen.
Candle on a stand proclaiming.
There are many ways we contribute to the life and work of being the church with our time, our talents, and of course with our financial offerings. And so as we reflect and listen to this piece of music, this musical offering, I invite you to reflect on how you can continue to support the life and work of this congregation and church family.
Let us pray. Loving God, as we offer up our gifts, we offer up the varied ministries of this congregation and church family, may each of us be a part of your answer to the cries of the world. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
We come now to a time of announcements and community sharing. And to give us a bit of insight into what our guides and scouts have been up to these past 11 months, I turn it over to Brad and Sharon.
Good morning. I'm Sharon Hamilton, and I'm with Fairview Guides. And
I'm Brad Hamilton, and I'm with 5th Brantford Scouting Group.
Just wanted to share a little bit this morning with what we've been doing in the last 11 months with our guides and scouts, because normally this would have been our Thinking Day service at Fairview. And since the end of March 2020, which we all realize, things have changed, and Fairview guides have had to accommodate these changes that we've made. We've met on a continuous basis. Initially, our platform was Zoom meetings. Through crafts and singing and online scavenger hunts, we stayed connected with all our guides. When we were able, we participated in outside in-person meetings, some on the lawn at the church, playing games, a neighborhood hike, and of course, more crafts. Just so you know, the group we have this year are really crafty. We discovered games in the rain are just as much fun. In fact, the guides seem to think they were even more fun. Our cookie drive through the fall was a huge success. Can't even begin to tell you how excited it was to see all the incredible support we got from both the congregation as well as the community at large. When our cookie supply was depleted that day, we brought in more cookies from other units just to meet the demand. And plus, although we were all socially distanced, at that point, we had the opportunity to actually be with people. Hooray! Our last in-person gathering was a hike at the beginning of winter down in Homedale to Wilkes Dam. Amazing experience for the guides and the guiders. It was at night with a starry sky, and we stood and just listened to the water as it flowed over the dam. With the second lockdown, our Zoom meetings resumed. We held a virtual paint night and created and posted Christmas Thinking of You cards for the Armed Forces personnel to enjoy during Christmas. We did baking challenges, and if anybody wants the recipe for microwave mug cakes, just let me know, because they're actually quite good. We held a Dragon Den type meeting where the guides made a product and then sold it to the rest of our unit on their business plan. All virtual, of course. And more recently, we made puppets and virtually traveled the cosmos with these puppets. And that meeting was run completely by our guides. COVID didn't stop us. We just found other ways to keep guiding going. Hopefully, we have helped to show and inspire our youth members to look at problems as opportunities, to do things in a different way. The new way just might be better than the usual way.
Hi, Brad back here, the scouter. Everything that Sharon, my guiding friend, said is fantastic, and I personally think the guides do a much better job than the scouts. However, having said that, scouting is continued. We have faced some challenges. As with most other groups, youth and otherwise, 5th Brantford Scouting Group has been a victim of the global COVID-19 pandemic. We normally meet at Cedarland Public School and lost the facility in mid-March 2020, almost 12 months ago. Since that time, we have met outside, primarily and virtually using Zoom. Our normal scouting year ends in August, however, was extended last year to December 31st. We were and are unable to do overnight camping, and day camps are restricted in size. Our Cub and Beaver sections have met virtually and have had some outside activities such as hikes along the Grand River, and we have had a joint day camp at our scout camp. Whoops. The scout section has met outside the school and at one of the scouters' properties when permitted. Some of our normal historic events have been lost in 2020, hopefully to return some of them at least this year. Our beaveries, our cubberies, our apple day, and in particular, our participation in the Remembrance Day services in Brantford, which we have done very, very often over the years. And that's enabled the kids to learn about the importance of remembering. We lost our Halloween costume and our Christmas celebrations. Program work has suffered the lack of in-person meetings. The annual all-section buggies, cars, and truck races have been lost, which would occur this month. In fact, would have been this last Saturday. We hope this resumes in some sort this year because it was a very good event for all sections to be in a building and learning environment. While our numbers have suffered given the uncertainty of virtually everything, we continue to hold Zoom meetings with crafts, games, and conversation. We are working towards a return to the new normal, whatever and whenever that might be. This Sunday is a traditional, as Sharon has indicated, Guide Scout Thinking Day Founders Day event that we have been fortunate enough to be invited to at Fairview Church for a number of years. Scouting and guiding have endured many successes and challenges over 100 years. We will come through this time as well. We will also remember, we also like to remember during Scout and Thinking Day celebrations of the Scouters that have come and gone. And we're always enjoyed seeing past members stand during the and be identified during the process. We also remember in Fairview and in our celebration those Scouters that have gone home. We remember them and we will continue to remember them. Thank you again for the memories, thoughts, and the prayers.
Thank you, Sharon and Brad. And to let you know a little bit of what's gone on at the church this weekend, I turn it over to my past self. It's Saturday morning here at Fairview, and we've got some exciting stuff going on today. I know many of you are aware that part of our grant for technology also included some upgrades in the sanctuary that will ultimately allow us to more effectively live stream and be present in the sanctuary. And the heralds are here today setting things up. So I thought I'd take you into the sanctuary to have a look. So let's go. Camera being mounted up on the beam. Lots of monitors involved, not in their final positions, and just getting some things loaded up, and the other camera that's going to be at the back, still very much a work in progress. So the learning will most definitely continue, an exciting update, along with other updates. I know on Friday in Fairview Happenings, we shared that we're going to continue virtual only worship for the next little while, especially what with variants and so many unknowns, that we will continue online for now, continuing to talk about it, continuing to look to the time when we can more easily gather in person. Our annual meeting we are going to postpone until May or June. The United Church has allowed annual meetings to be any time before June 30th, and so our hope will be to meet at such a time when we will be able to be in person, whether that's outside or some combination of Zoom or in person. But we will keep you informed. In the meantime, we have sent out the annual report by email, and hard copies will be made available upon request and to those we know who aren't on email. Our Tuesday afternoon Let's Chat sessions will continue. I know last week I said we would start with one and see how it goes. I was thinking one time slot, like we're going to go with Tuesday, not Tuesday and Friday as our parking lot things had been, but made it sound as if it was a possibility that it wouldn't continue. But we had a nice turnout, a nice conversation, and so those will continue 1 to 2 on Tuesdays. And other conversation groups continue, the Wednesday morning scripture group, the Sunday morning pre-service discussion group. And today, this Sunday, immediately following the service, we are going to have a second coffee time of conversation around the information that was shared 2 weeks ago by Beth and the board. looking at all of the different options that Fairview is exploring, looking to the future. And so a couple of weeks have passed now, and so we are offering this time immediately following the service to have some conversation, ask some questions, and just talk about it. So I encourage you to check that out. In terms of prayer request and things to keep in mind, it's my understanding that Deborah has arrived back, so we hold her in prayer, as she of course will need to quarantine now for a couple of weeks here, and we'll continue to do our music as we have been. And so if you have a prayer request at this time, I'd invite you to put it in the chat box so that we can hold that prayer for you. And so let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we give thanks for the many blessings of life, for family and friends, for neighbors and loved ones, those who fill our lives with joy and companionship, even in these times of separation. We give thanks for the technology that's allowed us to find new and creative ways of being in touch. We give thanks for our scouts and guides. We miss having them in our service today, but we offer up a prayer and look to the times when we will be able to celebrate Thinking Day, Founders Day, with them again. And while we recognize there are many things for which we give thanks, birthdays and anniversaries, the celebrations of life, we recognize that we come to worship as full people, complete with worries and fears and anxieties. And so we offer up the prayers of our hearts. We pray for those we know who are grieving, who are ill, who feel alone. Isolation is such a challenge at this time. We lift up the leaders of our city, our province, our country, as they try to navigate and find a way forward as we approach the year mark of the pandemic. We offer up a prayer for our world, that we might continue to find new and sustainable ways of living into the future, using our Earth's resources, that the world might continue to flourish for ours and future generations. And so we lift up the prayers of our hearts, those we voiced aloud, those we've put in the comments, and those we carry too deep for words, trusting in your presence with us always. And so may we join generations in praying the prayer Jesus taught his disciples to say in whatever language or version is most comfortable and familiar to you. One common version will be on the screen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We may be a little premature in singing our closing hymn, but it is a hymn that is part of the Lent section, and I always like to sing it towards the beginning of Lent because it's really beautiful, and this way maybe we'll sing it again a little closer to spring, but as the sun with longer journey.
Beneath the earth, may the
And so as we go forth from this time of worship, as we go forth into our day, may we go sure in the knowledge of our value and belovedness in the heart of God. And may we go with the grace and peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, keeping watch over our hearts and minds now and always. Amen.